loan?
Yes.
Welcome to the third session of the National Webinar Series on Ethics in Higher Education, organized by IQAC Mar Athanasius College Autonomous Kodamangalam under UGC Paramarsh Scheme. I invite Dr. Diana and Isaac for the welcome speech.
Thank you, Sridhar ma'am. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
A very good evening to one and all of you, and it's good morning to you, Jagannath Rao sir.
Thank you.
Today marks the final day of the National Webinar Series on Ethics in Higher Education, organized by the Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Mar Athanasius College, Kodamangalam, Kerala. Speaking about our college, we are a premier arts and science college, primarily catering to the central part of Kerala, established in the year 1955. We are accredited by NAC with A+ grade and conferred with autonomous status. We are also ranked 86th in India in the NIRF ranking of 2021, conducted by the Ministry of Education, Government of India. IQAC, Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Mar Athanasius College, has been pioneering a lot of initiatives for promoting and institutionalizing quality culture in the college. And this national webinar series is one instance of that. It's a great honor and privilege that Professor K.S. Jagannath Rao sir has given consent to be the speaker for today. He is the director of Institute for Scientific Research and Technology Services, Republic of Panama, a distinguished scientist and an influential speaker. He holds his country close to his heart. With great respect and even greater admiration, I welcome you, sir, to Mar Athanasius College, Kodamangalam, and to this national webinar series. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
May I also take this moment to welcome our dynamic principal, Dr. Shanti Avira ma'am, faculty members, research scholars, students, and the entire web of audience who have joined us today through this Zoom platform. Thank you. Over to you, Eldo sir, for formal introduction of the resource person. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon and welcome to the third lecture in this webinar series. Today we have Professor K.S. Jagannath Rao as our resource person. He is currently working as the director of Institute for Scientific Research and Technology Services in the Republic of Panama. It's been a privilege to introduce such an eminent academician to this webinar. He completed his PhD from Sri Venkateshwara University, Tirupati, India. His areas of expertise include neuroscience, mechanisms of proteins conformation in neurodegenerative disorders, and development of Alzheimer's and traumatic brain injury in animal models, stem cells in brain disorders, metals in human brain, neurotoxicology, biomarkers, biofoods, and indigenous medical plants. Dr. Rao is in the editorial board of 20 international journals. He has guided about 20 PhD fellows and about 8 postdoctoral fellows. He is on the International Review Board of Parkinson's Disease Association, United Kingdom. He is also in the panel committee on stem cell research protocols in India. He is a fellow of National Academy of Sciences, India. Also, he is a fellow of Linnean Society, United Kingdom, and Association of Biotechnology and Pharmacy, Singapore. He is a guest editor for 2 special issues of journals on Alzheimer's disease. He has international collaborations with scientists in USA, UK, Italy, Germany, Taiwan, Japan, etc. He has published 120 papers and 6 book chapters. With great respect and admiration, I welcome you, sir, for the talk. I have a piece of information for the participants. Dr. Rao inspired us to give prizes for the best questions from the side of participants. So I'm looking forward an active and interactive section in the coming time period. So all the best for the participants. I once again welcome Dr. Rao for the talk. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Can you allow me to put my slides?
Sure, sir, sure. Sir, can you, is it able to?
It says host disabled participant screen sharing.
Oh. So
you should allow sharing.
So can you try it now?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's visible now, sir.
But able to see my slides?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Can I start?
Yeah, you can start now, sir. Yeah.
Good evening to all of you. And profoundly thank to the management committee of the Autonomous College and also Sarita Madam for giving me an opportunity to share some of my thoughts, you know, on the research, you know, education ethics and research composition. The India, Government of India has announced a new education policy in July 2021, highlighting that the Indian education model should become a global leadership, and especially global education model incorporating new things and inculcating the practice of research component and research thinking in the minds of young people and their teaching practices, even that is very important, and developing students with multiple skills. It's not just you teach what is there in the book, but you have to turn them into a multiple skill ability parameters, which will fit for not only for the industries, but also future academic institutions. And also we need to make our students globally competitive. That's one of the important composition we need to work out, because we have to look how the world is moving. Accordingly, we need to prepare our ground, you know. And then, as I said, it's not just from book to brain. It's not just we read something and say, okay, this is what you are going to learn, but this is beyond learning. That is very, very important process. And a very important composition is during training, you know, during school education or college education, students should be more innovative. Students should be able to understand. Students able to interact, not just listen. So it is always an interactive model, and especially ethics-based education model. That's very important. Without moral ethics and educational ethics and then skills, you cannot be a successful person in life, because you are not able to achieve the goals what you want. See, one of the important research has, what is ethics? You know, ethics is a principles you follow to dedicate yourself to in a respectable manner. That is the main ethics. So ethics come in education, ethics come in research, ethics come in teaching. So that means it is for the students, it is for the faculty, and also it is for the community, and also it is for the new innovations. Everywhere we need to respect the question of principles and the question of understanding, mainly the respecting each other. That's important. If you know how to respect your professionalism, then you are going to be a good person to teach ethics in the world. That's a very, very important composition in the process. Now, coming to the current situations in the world, as you know that you are reading many things, like, you know, you have United States, you have UK, you have Australia, you have Japan, you have many, many countries ahead in their education models, and everybody is looking for global models, globalization system. What is globalization system? In a global model, what happened? We always bring talents to the level of the solving the problem, analyzing the problem in an analytical way, and understanding the problem in a holistic manner. So those are the, that means you understand the whole problem in system. So you just understand the information from the book, but transform into new skilled knowledge. That is what is called research-based university. You go to any universities abroad now, many Western universities, they're adapting the model of the research-based system. In the sense, you learn the process of analysis, you learn the process of innovation, you learn the process of thinking, and you learn the process of analytical bent of mind in the process of, in, even from the school education, from the school to university. Not that you become a research scholar after a master program, then you learn about research. That was the olden days model going on. But now the system is, the students become competitive in research from the school level itself. And there are journals, you know, school students can able to publish their papers in a journals like Young Scientist Journal UK, and then Canadian Journal for Young Scientists, and Young Minds is a frontier journal. Like so many journals which are exclusively for school kids, that, you know, till the age of 21. So that means till they finish their undergraduate level, you know. So there is huge competitiveness was built, that kind of thing. So to build that, we need teachers who are motivating the students, and also teachers who have that composition of thinking that, okay, this is the problem I am going to give you. Please solve using algorithms or using the principles of Newton's law or anything you should be able to give this practice. Why? What that helps, you know? It helps you two things, two fundamental things. One is critical thinking, and the second one is life skills. You learn both. You know how to solve the problem, and then you use your brain to understand how you are going to activate this process. The brain of a human brain is so critical that it has many multiple compositions, which I will explain later in my talk. How you are going to incorporate that novel base, you know, is a very important composition. The universities play a very dynamic role. That means the colleges, universities, and schools play a very dynamic role in developing this kind of practice in the students. So we teach the basic principles from the books, and the students are allowed to read the books, but we teach more innovations for the students to practice. That's very important. If I am teaching an hour, I expect students to be very active and promotive, asking many, many questions. And you know, that's very dynamic. Never feel this question is good or this question is bad. Always feel question is a question. That means you have a feel to understand new things. So there's no right question, wrong question. Oh, I don't know whether people like my question, whether people appreciate, no such thing. question is always an open system for the process. And then there are some colleges which don't have potential to develop a research base. We know because research also involves a lot of things. So those colleges transform, they call community colleges in West, like US and other thing. They call them as liberal arts colleges. Liberal arts colleges teach you all the basic techniques. For example, you are a zoology student. You think you are only studying animal models, you know, but you also learn the plant growth. You also learn the mechanical part of the engineering. You also learn basic principles of the electrical connections, all these things. So you have additional skills to use yourself into this process. So these are the multiple skill problems people create. That means you know only not only your subject, but also you know other than your subject. So this is a skilled process they develop in the students. Education models is not beyond culture, is not beyond the process. What we teach in education, in research, you know, ethics of education, first we have to teach each culture. What is culture? It's not just teaching about the country, but also teaching about the life, teaching about the process, and then teaching about the environment and community. This is very important. We should always learn the community models to know what we are going to contribute, how we are going to live in the community, how we are going to appreciate our energetic models. These are very, very important in the first part of education model. The second part, we also teach history, but also you have to teach competitiveness of the world, because we cannot live on the history all the time. We need to teach what is the world is looking for and what world is going to be in 2050, for example. It is not the same world which is going to be in 2050. And COVID is the best example we all the world went through. That means many, many of the people were not even prepared. Even in spite of science and technology, medical science development, still we lost many people. Because still we believe the competitiveness and research skill in medical sciences was not reached to the level where we can handle such emergencies. And the second important is the whatever information you have, you should be able to evaluate accurately, deeper understanding of the problem. That's a very important we should teach the students. And the second one important is while they're doing, they should have a freedom of expression. They should be able to come and ask us any question at any time. Even they have something in mind, they should be able to ask us even in the evening or any time, so that they should have that freedom of bubbling their mind into understanding the problem. That's very important. And the important is the communication. Communication is the biggest challenge in many countries. Many young students, many of them, you know, they don't know how to communicate their knowledge. So how to do that? So there is a model which we developed in Panama, we incorporated, I will explain you in the process, where a student become a teacher. It's called peer tutor model. So those are the competitiveness we need to build among the students. So that helps them to build the cross communication process. And then we have intelligent humanity and the humility, divergent thinking and technology literacy. Even the people in the arts should know how the technology is useful for the social sciences. So these are the very competitive models students should understand and teachers should understand, and we should educate the community in this process. One of the important aspects is, if you see the globe, you know, all over the world has different countries, different cultures, different, you know, modules, different student diversity, and different environments, and different economical and ethical and thinking processes. This is a composition, mixture of all over the world. So what are the opportunities? Look at the people from Africa to India to Asia to other models to in Europe to West, you know, like US and Canada. There are different modules happening around the world. One is the environment, educational environment. Second one is the teaching modules. Third one is the the practices of teaching, and fourth one is the opportunities. These are the major things happen. It's not just for student, but also to the faculty. So how we have to cross these borders? How we can incorporate the best model? How we can make our student more powerful? How we can make our faculty top in the process? Even in the person in rural India, how the faculty can get an opportunity to understand this process? So this is where we understand the student, you know, in group. See, once class is over, most of the student disappear. You know that. Most of the student finish and they think what they learned from the book or what they learned from the teacher is enough for them for the exam. But that was the practice, you know, going on in many parts of the world. But what we want to understand, that we want a freedom of thinking. We want a deeper understanding. We want people to express communication. That is possible when you have a meeting, a small group meeting, or even meetings after the class, where you should be able to incorporate. Because your class is only 8 hours, maximum 6 to 8 hours. After 8 hours, you should be able to prove your mind. You should bubble your mind for newer thinking. That's a very important, that we have to learn. That need not be taught by somebody. The colleges, faculty can take up that. That's called innovation time, where you teach. And some of the students become teachers. They teach other students, hey, I didn't understand the subject. You can able to teach. And sometimes social science problems will be solved by science students. So those are the cross-disciplinary interaction we should be able to allow. We should not separate them, separate the model in this aspect. So to achieve this kind, we should never have a barrier. So we should cross beyond barrier. We should allow students to cross beyond barriers. So they should know some students are excellent. Though they are the biology students or a physics student, but they want to apply their physical model in education system. They want to apply their physics model in understanding the biology. They want to apply their physics model in understanding the plant. So they should cross the beyond border. They should be able to coordinate with the process. So we should open, that means open model. We should allow, so a student have an ability or a freedom to learn. Similarly, a teacher. For example, a biology teacher don't teach biology alone. A physics teacher don't teach only physics people. The teacher, depending on the need, they go and teach other classes. So we should cross the cross-disciplinary process. That's a very, very important in innovative model of education. Then we can learn multidisciplinary composition in the students, in the faculty. Till then, you know, we only speak on multidisciplinary, but we never achieve that process. The important aspect is beyond background. You know that in most of the thing, we always think, oh, my teacher is coming, my thing, you know. We never have a liberty to ask our teachers, have a liberty to coordinate our faculty, tell them this what new thing I would like to learn. I read this information in a journal. For example, you should be always update the information from the journals and go to teacher and tell, oh, I learned new thing. I understand new thing. You are telling me this procedure, but I learned beyond this procedure. So you should have a debate in the classes. This is a very, very important thing, starting from school level to college level. Very important. What is beyond borders is not beyond background. Is not just you do in your school, in your college, you know. You should visit schools. You should go to rural areas. You should visit schools on your holidays or your time, you know, when you have time. And you should teach your knowledge to the younger students. That's very, very important. That as a student, as a faculty, you contribute to the students who are school kids, you know, small kids, but whom you are going to teach. You are not going to put a PowerPoint slide and teach them. No, you take a model. You take the model. For example, you teach an ecosystem, and Kerala has a beautiful ecosystem. You take them to the forest area. You take them to the pond. Show them what pond means a composition. How the pond is surviving. where the oxygen is coming in the pond, where the carbon dioxide, what is the role of microbes in the pond. All these things you should be able to come in. So that is a practice we should always learn to be a best teacher, to be a best model of education in the world. And then come, as I said earlier, starting from mathematics to social science to other aspects, psychology to everything, we need to understand as a holistic model. Many times we think we know many things. We have not invented many things. I tell you, even human brain, we only know 8%. We don't know even our brain. So we have 92% of our brain still is open question. That's why we have many, many problems in the world. Many problems associated with the human brain disorders, emotions, intelligence, you know, the kind of connectivity are still there problems. Those we did not understand even the fundamentals of the brain. So there's large amount of system existing. Don't say only mathematics is different than social science to humanities, to philosophy, to anything. There is a connectivity. We should always create the system. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
So one of the important thing which I always like to practice, and many, many places people are practicing, you know, important is the mentoring. Like, you know, when you see a teacher teaching model, always students try to mimic that. And we should make students more innovative than that. So then we connect them to many places. So we have what is the global mentoring model, where students become teachers. They teach many of the things, and when they're teaching, they teach beyond what the teachers teach. They don't teach the same way what you teach, because they learn many, many things, and they learn many of these compositions to put their innovations. So this is very important. So how it is possible? For example, student seminars we'll have, student conferences we have, like DBT, DSC, Indian Science Congress we have in India. We started the first program way back in, 1994. First time we told students should be admitted into Indian Science Congress. That's how we brought school students, everybody. We started a first program when I was in India. We started called Student Science Visiting Program. A first proposal, we got a new approval actually. We made it on a Student Science Visiting Program where school students visit a CSR facility. And they spend 7 days with us to learn things. So the students become mentors. Actually, at the end, students are going to speak what they learned, what their ideas, what their new thing. So student mentoring is a very important composition we should inculcate in many colleges and universities, because they play a very important, that is the time they learn communication, that is the time they learn the directions of thinking, and also innovation in the thinking, and ability to influence the community. That's important for us. It's not that just they learn something, but they become global model. So that is a very important, the students should always take advantage of doing this. Not necessarily a teacher, but also students do that. So we should practice these things in the colleges and university system so that we build the best brains and best models and best communicators, more than best education leader for future. One of the important things happening in many places in all over the world is the educating, you know, scientifically qualifying students into a best researchers. PhD has become like another master program in many, many places, as you know that. And always there is a criticism going on in all over the world. The very important is what a PhD means. PhD means not doing some research, not doing something, you know, learn from the teachers, but also things. But, you know, the PhD mentorship is something wonderful. You are building a career plan. you are building a future of a thinker of this world. That means mentor, that means the PhD guides play a very, very, very important role. They play a very dynamic role in making these two happen. So there are guidelines set up now. What is the role of mentor? People say, oh, students should read everything. No, you should read and you should challenge your student, yourself, your student. That's where you learn more innovations. If you do that, students really make very solid contributions and develop even their own industries. You look at the United States, you know, like Berkeley or MIT, this system, there are many students who does their own things and they solve the problems, and that problem has become industry. That means as soon as his PhD finished, he's a CEO of a company. There is so much competitiveness in the world is going. So we need to transform that model in our system. That's very important. PhD cannot be another program. PhD is truly innovative, truly a very competitive models. And there are some guidelines set up by the system, International Union of Biophysics and Biochemistry, American Association for Advancement of Science. What is the role of a student? What is the role of mentor in PhD program? This is very, very important to develop most innovative thinkers for the world. So we started in Panama, the first model we developed was on the Einstein model. So what we did was, imagine for a PhD, we know that everybody says we need to have a master program to do PhD, we need this, you know, we have a procedure because we follow education, normal routine education model. But you know, there are say things beyond, always think beyond. So what is that beyond? Means, for example, you look at Einstein, you look at Mendel and other people, they didn't have a fundamental education model. But those guys have come up with a marvelous contributions to the world. There are many, many people who come up with the new ideas, new challenges in the world. You see them often in the system. So very important education model we need to create. First, as a teacher, as a college, as a thing, we need to have an ecosystem, an environment into that. So one of the important is inspiring the student and challenge them, even in the class when you're teaching, challenge the mind. Same way, students should challenge their teachers. That means it's not fighting. It is a challenging knowledge. That's very important. A student should ask a question where the mentor or the teacher should wait for 10 minutes to answer. That means you have the best question. Where is the best question comes from? When you have a deeper thinking, deeper, go into deeper understanding of the problem, not just by reading books. You have to use your beyond 8% of your brain to achieve that. And the second one important is the collaborative, nothing secret. You need to understand this is a very collaborative person. And a very important is personality development. You should learn how you have to think, how you have to be innovative, how you have to be more open, how you have to be more communicable system. And then the students and faculty, both of them should always be innovative, bubbling ideas. When you're teaching, give them new ideas. Give them very complex ideas. Give them a complex, challenging problem the students will solve. Many times, you know, you also ask them how we can solve this problem. Let us do this. So let us give an opportunity for ourselves, for them to understand. Then your brain will have a very efficient understanding. And actually, when you do this, you live longer, you look younger, and you are going to have a healthy aging process. And then when somebody is doing a best performance, both as a teacher, as a student, we should always reward. Reward system is a very interesting part of the brain, you know that. Whenever even you give 10 rupees as a reward, people ask questions. You tell them, I won't do this. I won't inculcate that practice. It's not the reward, but the rewarding system is very important for activating the brain. So that's what one of the important things we see is not just we are telling, but we did a study called MRI scans, where we understand which of the part of the brains are going to activate when you have a reward system for them. Because people use multiple brain regions in this process. And then we have to become technology leaders, because technology is a part of our life in the world. So we need to become that in future without any space. And important, science is playing very dynamic role in the life. Science does not mean only physical science, biological science, engineering science. Science is philosophy. Science is understanding human psychology, everything. They play a very important role on that. So what are the leadership qualities? We think of making students very, very competitive composition. The first one, we look at the aspect. The first what we want to create is creativity. We are not interested to create knowledge directly. We want to creativity. They need to be a part of the community integrity. They need to think global. Then rest of the things will follow. This is very important for building up a student. When a student comes to class, first thing I do is I will project them. I tell them I want to look creativity in you. Then once you have creativity, you are the best. You will become a global leader for us. So to make this kind of composition, we should have communication networks between students. So they do, now you have Facebook, you have many, many things compared to old days. Now you can get connectivity. You can make groups, not necessarily from Kerala to Mumbai, Mumbai to Delhi and beyond. You can go to Nepal, you can do with China, with Australia. We can make a networking. So the colleges play a dynamic role in building that global networking for students, which need not travel. Now we have a Zoom meeting, you have many things, and COVID taught many new things also. So these are the perceptions people should have. That means college, teachers, and the students should be demanding in learning new things in the process. Let us not follow the monotonous, routine process of understanding. We should go beyond that. The important always is we have to train students on ethics of the research, ethics of the education model, how to solve a complex problem. We should not teach this simple problem, how to solve very complex problems, so that people know that, this complex issue can be resolved. For example, there's a complex problem in your area, for example, about environment, community issue, or a energy process. Let the student play a dynamic, let the faculty play a dynamic role in that. So understanding the solving. So what happens if you are able to solve the problem? You need not do experimental all the time. You can do theoretically also. So you have a theoretical model, you have an experimental model, you have many things. And anything you do, you can publish now. You can put your ideas. Nobody is going to prevent you. So that is an idea. That means you have a new idea, people appreciate. So we need to be beyond comfortable zone. You should come out. You should not think, oh, I'm not having this. I cannot go here again. You have to make trials. That's a very, very, very important. Once you have a knowledge, once you have innovation, any part of the world respects you. You have an opportunity to do that. So there are many people and many organizations in the world teach you how you need to be innovative, how you need to complex problem. Even you want to learn, your teachers want to learn. Sometimes you don't know how to do that. For example, your teachers don't know. Probably we should make that composition with the institutions. Same Zoom meeting what you have, let us have a Zoom meeting in solving one research problem. Let us take a research problem. Let us work out a strategy. Like one-to-one classrooms we do. So that way we will build capacity in the process. There are a number of opportunities for young students who are doing PhD and research, or even faculty. They want to go out for some time to learn many things. You have an opportunity. There are so many international travel awards, grants to go outside. So many awards. But we want young colleges like yours should utilize those opportunities. For that, you should be innovative. That's important. It's a competition. Because we are from a rural area, I don't have facility, I want to learn this. No, people don't do that. People want, in a way, you have a brightest idea. You are the king of the educational model there. You need to have the brightest idea. No matter you're a faculty or a student, you are anybody, we should do that. So the system of education, where we have the management, we have the student, we have the administration, everybody is a part of our community. Everybody play a dynamic role on that. And these are the scholarship for the young students who want to open up new things, who want to do things, collaboration. For example, somebody working with your physics department, PhD, they want to go 1 year to work in Italy, International Institute for Theoretical Physics. For example, you have a brightest idea. They pay you everything. So you don't need to block. What you need to do, you and your professor has to work out a strategy. That is what you call mentor, student, and the management, understanding and relationships, and understanding the process of novel models. So we have many, many scholarships like that. People can go 3 months, 6 months. Don't say there's no opportunity. Opportunity exists. Only thing is we should know. Somebody in the institution should educate student. Hey, we have this opportunity. You want to do this? A professor say, I connect this to this guy, or I talk to Rao, I'll get you a connection to you, and your idea is the best idea. Let us debate. Let us open up for the new opportunities in the world. All over the world, the opportunities exist. In Japan, many, many places we have. And then we also have International Center for Genetic Engineering Biotechnology in Trieste. We also have a campus in Delhi. We also have a campus in many places, in Africa and other places. See, for example, as a college young person, you can, even a brightest idea you have, you can apply cross-disciplinary. That means it's a complex biology coupled with physics, coupled with chemistry, coupled with mathematics, you can do that. Computer science modeling, artificial intelligence, data science, social science impact, all these things. So you get like $50,000 grant. And then there's so many joint opportunities. You want to send a student or a faculty want to go, they can do that process. So this is very, very important. Very important, your idea is innovative. You can publish in a good journals. Don't compromise. Because you want to reach global. You want to reach global. That's the ethics of the model. In education, research, it's not just you write a theoretical model. You don't know how to solve this because you don't have facilities. But put that theoretical model. That is going to be your milestone for future. We want thinkers, not just to do people experiments. We want thinkers who give the new ideas to the world. And then I was telling about theoretical physics. You have any idea in physics, you can go for training. They pay everything. They take care of things. What you need is they want bubbled energy in your mind. That's very, very important. We have also many, many scholarships for people to go outside for PhD. World Academy of Sciences, working with China, working with many other countries. We have Brazil, for example, Russia, Mexico. Many, many people work on the process. And then many, many opportunities exist in Germany and many other places, Australia, South Africa, many, many places where new composition thinking is possible. You can do joint program. You can also do the success of the one model. But always understand, people shake hands only with the people who have that capacity. That's important. So you should show that you have the best model in your thinking ability process. You have the greatest opportunity in Hong Kong, for example. huge competitive building is going on with a high educational temperament, because they have built the best technologies in the world. And there is great opportunity for people to go and work also to develop joint programs between institutions. There are places in nanoscience and with UK and all these places. I want to just tell you one line about the MRC facilities. MRC is a most innovative model the UK has built. For example, you have the most thundering information, thundering idea you want to resolve. For example, you write to MRC scientists, I have this best idea, I think. Then they debate with you, and you are the best idea, they invite you for a PhD program. You don't need to go through all the process. Your idea makes you to sell yourself. Same thing in Austria, Vienna. They also have a program to do this. There is so much in the world available. And then the people, very attractive to go to Germany because of the time limitation and also no tuition fee, and scholarships are very competitive. And Germany is the best to learn multiple skill models. They learn multiple skill models to do it. And you know, Germany has huge number of Nobel laureates with them. And then we have many, many awards within India, outside. This is outside awards. You have a great opportunity for teachers and faculty to do that. And we have many awards for the people within the system. Even in India, we have. Coming to the opportunities you have, but now question comes, how we want to become innovative? How to use our brain? How we need to build capacity, multiple thinking? How I want to be a global leader in thinking? Imagine you have the brain which is 1.5 kilograms. No matter you are a man, no matter you are a woman, no matter you are an American, Indian, Australian, anybody, your brain weight is 1.5 kilograms. And then you have like 2,000 identified so far, 2,000 regions in the brain. And each region has a segment for anything, for your emotion, for your thinking, for your anxiety, for your depression. For all these things, you have centers identified. Even if I say I'm giving reward system, I will know how one person think a reward system compared to other person. If I do MRI, I will know that. So there are so many opportunities. There are so many new things available. Somebody can ask me, oh, we don't have MRI to do in nearby. How can we do? You have MRI scans all over the world. We have MRI bank. You want to develop an artificial intelligence model, you can develop. So understanding this is a very, very complex. Brain, one reason I am talking, only one part of the human body, brain is such a competition to that. Still, we did not understand our brain. But we have done many innovations, true? So that means we are using the brain, but we still don't know where to trigger. And that's why we have still problem with our brain disorders, like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, depression, anxiety, even emotional failures. We have that. The controlling emotional failures is a big challenge. So those are the very competitive things happening in the world. If you look at the very complex brain, like you have trillions of cells, and each cell has a connectivity, almost 10,000 connections each has. And one connection lost, you have a problem. And you have, if you cut the head, you have two halves, right and left part of the brain. And they have functionality, sleep problems, intelligence, language, and then skills understanding. All these things, ability, and important at the end is the learning modalities. These are the new composition which we have capacity to be able to learn to do this process. If you look at our things, linguistic to mathematical to musical, that means everybody has these kind of things. What we have to do, this 7 interpersonal, intrapersonal intelligence coefficients we should incorporate. Everybody has that brain. Everybody has this capacity. So we should put that holistic model into that rather than specializing one aspect. For example, when you are young, why we study because we don't work in the young and study in the old group, you know. Why we study when we want to? Because when you start aging, you start aging from the day one, you know that. You become 1 year, 2 years, 4 years, 10 years, you know, 12 years, 20 years. But your brain don't age till you are 28. That means your brain is as young as the first one, first year, till 20 years. The volume will increase, but brain will never age. That's why we make people to study and incorporate as many problems as possible, as many challenges as possible into the brain. Students will never feel stress. Stress means they are not able to organize the part of the brains so that they will able to understand this problem. So that is very important. You should be able to organize. Once you have that, you have no stress. When you don't organize, you have a stress. That's what the main problem happens. In the stress biology means, oh, my teacher is stressing, my father is stressing, my mother is stressing, somebody is stressing. We always, where does the stress come? You should know how to organize. How to organize the challenges given by your community or your faculty or by anybody. You should know how to do that. Don't close your brain. Don't put barriers around that so you feel stress. When you open up, you are the most exciting person to learn many things. See, for example, when you stress, how do you know? People say, I am stressed. What is stress? When you are really stressed, first one is the sleep disturbance. Sleep is a very important composition. First one is the sleep disturbance. Then you feel heart bumping. You have no heart problem, but your heart bumping because of anxiety. You feel restlessness. You feel concentration problem. So you have to, these are the major problem, biological problem. Imagine this is going to affect your health. This is going to affect your beauty. This is going to affect your, you know, the process of your aging. All these things, your biological, physical outlook and also your functional outlook will be affected. That's why, please don't get stressed. You have to understand how to open up your minds to the new thinking and new learning. So one of the important things, we see this problem, many of us, you know. For example, when you are stressed, when you have, we don't know how to handle your situation. You gossip, you self-talk, then you developing criticism, you only tell, you know, everything is negative. Then or you isolate, you avoid, or you become overworked or overeat, many, many things. And then one important thing many people face is the hallucinations. If somebody is talking, you think they are talking about you. There are so many things, and never adapt that. That's important. This will become an adaptation in your model. So in your education model, you get learning process. That means you have, we have to teach these things to the student so that the best we cannot last. The best we cannot last, because they don't know what it is. They get adapted to things because they feel kind of stress. People should know in the day one what is stress. So people should know that it is not something uncommon. You need to know it is all your brain that is going to operate the process. And then this is how you look. When you have a stress and emotional, you look more ugly, you know that. Because it is not that you put a face. Your muscular system, your neurotransmitters cripple your things, because your mind is diversifying all the mechanism of your reactions. This is a very, very important. You don't want to look more ugly like this. You want to be more sweetful person in life, because this is a very important part. It is your life and your community. That's very important. So if you stress, in future, we have difficulties with memory, all these things. But when you are old, you want to be very active, very young. Even at 98, you should be able to tell a story. You should be able to teach people. See, there are, because normally we think after 60, we have to retire. Retirement is a physical phenomena. Mentally, you are active. You can do all the activities, never depend on system. This is what we have to, as a young student, you have to teach community. Community should be taught. That means you should know the basic composition of social science, engineering science, and biological sciences to know this. So this comes only when you start reading. You are open, you open up your mind because you understand many things. This is a part of life. This is not just knowledge of a book. It's a part of your life. All these things happen in your life. You should know your skills. You should know your abilities. So the very important also you should learn how your genes, your DNA plays a very important role. For example, if you think positive, why I said in the beginning, if you gossip, you develop, gossip, you get fear condition, all these things, your DNA will change. This discovery was not done in America. This discovery was done by a student when I was in India, in Mysore, you know that. So this was quoted one of the novel discoveries in an international meeting. And this girl was always thinking, oh, I think the brain problem comes because the DNA rotation changes. So that thinking comes when you go into deep understanding of the process. That's why even today we don't have medicines for depression, for anxiety, for many of these. I wish some of you will come up with some new ideas to resolve this kind of complex issues in this process. And then also, since when the DNA rotates in the brain, that means your thinking ability, your modules to understand, your modules to do things change. Why I am telling DNA in the ethics of education? Because teachers, students, both reciprocate, you know that, including your management. That means you create such an environment, you have a positive mindset, positive thinking ability, that makes your DNA positive turns. That is very important for you to become a genius. What is genius? People say, I'm not genius, he's genius. No, you have to have that composition that you make your positive mind so your DNA rotates in the right direction. That means right-handed DNA, then you become the super, you know, thinker. That's very important. So DNA, if it rotates on left, like it's called GDNA model, and then that is going to affect your gene expression thinking abilities. So what you think is in your hand, in the environment, what we are going to create this process. How do you say this? Look, we did a study starting from rabbit in a condition to human. We understand when you do MRI, we understand if you put a positive things, how your activation of the brain regions influence your thinking, critical thinking model, how it make you a positive interpersonal relationship person, how it makes you to be a very happy person, how you make you things. And then when you look that activity, because why you ask me why rabbit? Rabbit is always an active animal, you see that. It always keep doing things. It keep running. You don't see a rabbit in a depression. But we created a depression rabbit, you know that. So using a chemical model. So when you compare between human and thing, we identify how important the brain plays a very important role in the dynamics of the human biology. Also in the community system is very, very important. So whatever you learn, whatever you do, how you spend your time, how you think, how your mentors or teachers influencing you, how the management influencing you, how the reward system influencing you, all will be imprinted in your brain. All will be imprinted in your brain, and you make a challenges in future. You can become a best leader or you can be a problem for the society and for yourself. And the very important story at the end is everybody, we want to live longer and we want people to be very active. And we want everybody to be healthy. Even at the age of 98, you should be a very healthy person. If you don't control your system, if you don't build up a community, these are our groups, students and labs working. For example, if we don't build up the community, we don't build up the system, what happened? You yourself will have the issue on this process. That means understanding education is not just education. It influences your biology. It influences your life. This is a very important that you should know. Ethics starts from education to ethics in life. That's a very important, but you need to build a very competitive education model and take the opportunity when you are young. Use your brain, because it's very important. Education is not just book. You should use your brain, make yourself dynamic and active. That is going to lead to new things in your life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for the informative session. I think both the students and faculty who have participated would have gained from this session. And as mentioned in the beginning, we have some prizes for the best session. So I request the participants to actively interact with the resource person.
Questions, please. Feel free to ask questions. Don't hide any questions, okay?
So there is one question coming in the chat box.
Yes, please.
Critical thinking in some way, does it induce stress?
The critical thinking will never induce stress, because stress is a composition when you don't think. When you think, that makes your brain active and happy. And when you are thinking, when you are asking questions, when you are modeling, you know, you always feel happy. So critical thinking will never induce any stress at all. If you feel it is a stressful, that means you are not critically thinking. You are only thinking. You want some more information? This is enough for you. The student, Binita?
She's our faculty.
Yeah. So I will just add a few more points. Is when you add a critical thinking, that means when you think very critically, that means critically means multidimensionally, what will happen? You will induce what is called emotional hormones. When you induce emotional hormones, when you are thinking, you know, positively, and when you are critical thinking is always positive, it's not negative, you know that. And that induces emotional hormones, you know, adrenaline and other things that always keep you relaxed and brain active and happiness. That's why you never have a stress under that part. So if you are happy, that means you are really and critically thinking. That mean, that is the meaning of biology behind critical thinking. The sleep pattern, you are absolutely right. Binita's question is really good. The thing I tell you, when you critically thinking, you become restlessness, because you are not finding the answer. That's where you need to get an interaction with the people and get the answer for that. So because the critical thinking means you're always trying to find a true in a multidisciplinary parameter. That means you are really working on this process. That means you don't need to feel restlessness. You feel, you think, because you are not getting answer. But that's where you need to interact with the teams or with the people, either inside or outside the country, and get the answer. Once you have that, what you call the starvation, you feel the starved, you know, to learn good answers for your question, then you don't have restlessness. And then you think you are not sleeping because you are thinking. Still you don't have answer. That's why you feel disturbed sleep. That's what you think. But you have to find a way that you get this, and actually you are sleeping in a good model. But you are thinking in your sleep. That's what is happening. So you think you are not, it's not affecting your sleep. It is making your sleep more dreamy. Called dreams in sleep, we call. When you think something very sweet, very hard, that's what you create a dream. we call bad dreams and good dreams. Dream biology is one of the important part of the human biology. And then dreams are very good for human because you lose stress, you know that. Either bad dreams or good dreams. So that's very important. So don't worry, keep critically thinking, but try to find answers. You will get it. This is an excellent question, Bindu. Hormones are the small molecules we call as signal molecules. They keep changing your body, in your body, playing a role as only a transmit. They are like bus, in a bus station, the buses keep moving. They never remain same. They keep moving, Similarly, hormones, they act according to your need. And once that is done, hormone levels should become normal. Hormones will never keep higher level unless otherwise there is a disorder, metabolic disorder. Other than that, hormones always, for example, your emotional hormones, there are some adrenaline makes you happy and other thing. For example, all these things, they don't keep you happy all the time, So, but those hormones will come when there is a sweet feelings or when a hard feelings, and then they will stay that transit time and they disappear. They never be same all the time. Hanaya Pal is asking about the rewarding system, how it is going to work in a Western system, and then how it is going to be faculty and students. See, this is a very interesting model. In Western system, we don't have a uniform scales, in India, we have a scales. Like we say, assistant professor these, like that we have a model. But in Western system, the reward, that means either cut of salary in terms of anything, will be a model based on your knowledge, based on your capacity, based on your new thinking, and based on the evaluation done by the students. So these are the models they follow. That means you are a professor in the university, one guy will get like $100,000, another guy get $200,000, another guy get $500,000. Same like doctors. One guy get $1 million, even a spine surgeon. How the reward system varies is depending on how best you have the research model. That means you are a critical thinker and a very exciting model. So you get a lot of grants, you get a lot of new ideas. And when you have a lot of new ideas, you become the director of that program and you develop new thinking ability. There is no system, a routine system followed. No routine system followed. The people always look for new ideas, new innovations, and the people were rewarded accordingly. For example, a young guy of 32 years will become director of a center. Maybe 60 years man still there, but this guy has brought a new change, brought a new innovation in the institute, brought a new model in the education and research, and that makes world famous, that attracts people all over the world. Say, for example, I will tell you one example of UC Berkeley. UC Berkeley started what is called engineering, innovation engineering program. The teaching model is they teach everything in the practical forms. That means they take you to industry, they take you to a place, because if I want to teach about a traffic management, they teach in the system. This was developed by one professor, Eklak, Professor Eklak. And now he built an innovation engineering center, operational center. Who can do that course? Computer science, mechanical engineering, data science guys, civil engineering, and other, electrical, electronics. So that is how the reward system changes. So most innovative you are, the reward system for any person is thing. No age barrier, no financial barrier, and no barrier for your gender. No matter you're a man or woman, young or old, Your talent plays a very important role in Western. Same thing for students. For example, if students want a scholarship, they will not be given scholarship based on just your percentage. You get in your undergraduate anything. What they do, they want you to write a most emotional SOP, you know, your emotional touch, what you have to write. So you have to say why you want to do this course. What makes you think? It's not just because you are interested, you want to do, because you are poor, you want a scholarship. No. How you want to think this is going to change your life? How you think you are changing the community? If you write all these things and your essay, when a person, five people read, normally this happens in Western universities. Once you write an essay for a scholarship, five people read and they rank secretly A+ like that. And somebody says, oh, this is most innovative concept. This guy has a new idea. So that means you have to write your, that's why I'm telling you, you have to practice your critical model of thinking and critical model of expression. Important, sometimes you have something you write. People say, I will write because I'm a poor guy. I don't have money. I don't have. No, people have to write their life experience as an essay and you get 100% scholarship. 100%. And people adapt you. You can tell, I don't have anything to leave. I don't have even travel award. People get you travel awards even from the West. So there are a number of universities looking for great think abilities. That's why reward system is completely different in the West. That's why West is always not losing the best ideas. That we have to learn that practices in other parts of the world.
Good evening, sir.
Is okay? Anything you need more information?
Thank you, sir. Yeah. It is all clear.
I have a question, you know, about the student rising. This is very important. We always make students rise questions, means the faculty should be always open mind. This is a very, very critical model. Because in many places, students don't rise because of the faculty. You know that. Because many faculty don't like a student asking a challenging question. But we should always prepare students, ask them more challenging questions. No matter is good question, is a bad question. Question is a question. Question means intelligence. That means you are using your brain. If you don't ask question, you are not using your brain. Because that's a model, you know. You get something to ask questions. So when you have that question, that's a very, very important that you become very talented. So this is what we do. Teachers should become a model for asking questions. If, for example, you have 1 hour teaching. Normally when I practice, I teach only 40 minutes, even sometimes 30 minutes. And when I'm teaching, I always tell students, raise your hand. So ask me a question, no worry. Even if I don't finish in 1 hour, I'll continue in the evening. But let us do that practice. Let us not allow students not to ask questions. And sometimes some students don't ask questions because of the fear, because of the hesitation. Teachers should play, hey, you ask this question. You ask this question. Make them inspire. Force them to ask questions. That's why you practice the thought of asking questions in your process. That's a very, very important, comes from. There is a very interesting question on intelligence coming from the parents, you know that. The genes, as I said, everybody has DNA. And we also should understand, everybody has DNA and no DNA is bad or no DNA is good. See, I already told you now if you are a bad parent, parent in the bad means you have all the bad thinking, bad, you know, negative process. Your rotation of the DNA will be altered, you know that. But what you are creating environment for your children, no matter you are a parent, no matter you are a teacher, no matter you are a management of the institutions, you should always give academic freedom. You should give freedom of thinking, freedom of expression, freedom of organization of their capacities. That's very important. You can make any child genius, any student genius. What we need to do is that. As a faculty, yourself, you have to become changed yourself, and then you have your system. That's why we call in Western system, collegiate environment. What is collegiate environment? A institution with a full of freedom. Full of freedom. Anybody can go to principal at any time, ask any questions, ask anything he needs to do. He says, I have a new idea. I want to develop this. I want this. Find some money. Find a way to help them. Because innovation cannot be lost in the institutions. It cannot be lost in the institutions. We need to incorporate that new thing that is going to make a big change in the colleges, in the universities, in India, or any part of the world. Any part of the world. And makes, because there's no barrier from 8 to 5 is your college. No. If students want more time, yes, we can teach them till 8 o'clock, 7 o'clock. And the management is hardly going to provide some food. So we should be able to do that kind of thinking. For example, somebody asked me about West. So what is the reward system? People say, oh, I have an idea. I want to discuss. All the students who are interested, please come. So you go there. And the institution will provide some pizza, some juice and other thing. And all of them start debating up to 10 o'clock. Though that is not relevant to them, they sit. Because this challenge is posed by a professor. Sometimes students pose questions. So when students pose questions, faculty will go. So there is nothing like you have a barrier. We should cut beyond barriers. That's why I said beyond borders. If we do that, I think we will be most innovative model, that we should start from schools and colleges. You have that opportunity to change that. Somebody asked me about the data analysis and different EAGs. Yes, we have it's called brain scans and also brain imaging studies done with reference to different age groups. And there are many, many studies related to human brain. Very interesting part they have done. Like, when they are very young, they go through the insults, we call, because of the people don't understand, parents or the community don't understand. They put an insult in the brain. So when that kind of subconsciousness insult reach, how the brain keep changing over the age, how things happen, and also how we do the aging process for that. So that is what is called brain check, we call. And a lot of studies are going on. For example, suicidal symptom is one of the major challenge in the students. So people don't understand what is suicidal, what the problem, why they commit this. So that analysis can be done using the different imaging modules with not too expensive, but very simple models, but people need to analyze the data process. So now, for example, we have a COVID, and COVID affecting the anxiety issues. And we also know that some people have COVID reaching their brains. So we are starting a world international study where almost more than 1 million scientists are going to participate to do their pattern. Some people give ideas, some people do data analysis, some engineers build artificial intelligence, some social scientists build the social composition, psychologists build the approach to resolve the complex issue. That means one problem all over the world people are taking. So there's a good amount of data in the world going on to analyze the brain at different age models. You're right.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I have three doubts.
Yes, please.
The first one is relating to the curriculum. Normally, sir was addressing an issue relating to improving the brain skills or increasing the brain capacity of the students. But normally in the world, no universities or no schools have ever designed such a curriculum for improving any part of the brain. Actually, we are learning mathematics or science or social sciences, but no university or no schools are focusing upon improving the brain capacity, how to think more effectively, more creatively, that focused brain training is not happening. Do we think that such an effort will make a dramatic change in the scholarly atmosphere? That is my first question. And my second thing is that the chanting of Gayatri Mantra is found to have profound effect upon brain development. One research study, which was conducted by an Indian in UK, it proved that. Why such a chanting of mantras or some positive affirmations are increasing the capacity of the persons? It is proved from the book of Rhonda Byrne in the book of Secret and relating to the law of attraction. Sir, why such an effort is not taking place in our universities? That means how the people have to attain something. For that, why such proven practices are not being approved by any of these universities? And my last question is that, sir, you were telling that motivation or reinforcement from outside, rewards received by a person from his environment will increase his capacities. But is it the reward from outside, or is it the positive affirmations which I am giving to myself, that I am good, I am right, I have the capacity? Is that positive affirmations which I tell to myself, is it better, or is it a reward from outside? Which one can improve my brain capacity, my achievement level? So these are my humble questions, and I expect... Yeah.
No, these are excellent questions, not humble questions, honestly. This is the best questions, honestly. So Sarita can note down on this, you know. The very important first question you said about the university models. No, universities are doing this. The number of universities, for example, you go to a small university, I'm not talking MIT, Harvard, or Stanford, or someone. There are small universities in US and also in Egypt, for example, Alexandria University. Some of them, they're really practicing the beyond border curriculum. For example, a student doing physics will go and do a course in molecular biology because he wants to understand the physics aspect of life or physics aspect of molecules. Like he wants to learn on DNA, how DNA really bridge the bonds and other things, how the rotation restrictions are there in DNA, for example. Those things are done. That means the student need not take all physical curriculum. The student will take part, and then he said, my interest is this. So he will go a specific process. But not all people will do. Very limited students will do, and that is allowed. So students are given an opportunity to do that. I tell you one example. We have a student in my own institution. The guy is a biology student, but he wants to work in a microwaves, a physics part, you know. And we all know that microwaves are for cooking purposes. You know, we use and many other things. But they were trying to treat for malaria. They want to induce the death of malaria without killing RBC in the body. So the guy is a biology guy. The guy doesn't have other background. Then we have to teach human medicine, you know, human biology. Because when malaria is there, malaria also have a molecule called hemogene, which is equivalent to hemoglobin. Same iron binding proteins. For example, if he want to create a microwave and separate them. And then when he separate them, he thinks malaria parasite is going to die. But also if we separate, it may separate hemoglobin. Then the humans also going to, not only malaria parasite, but humans also get affected. So we made this guy go through a special courses in human biology. Then we asked him to do a course in biomedical physics. I work with the Indian Institute of Theoretical Physics there. So what we did, we helped this boy because this is a most unusual question. Imagine this thinking got the project from Melinda Bill Gates Foundation. It's called Global Challenging Project, $100,000. And when he successfully show that in a cell, it is only killing malaria parasite because of the specific radiation he's going to use. Now he won the, Melinda Bill Gates Phase 2 grant. So what we say, depending on the necessity of the students, depending on the innovation of the student thinking, the teachers and the universities should develop the modules. There's no restriction on that. So they get the same credits for the things they are doing, but they are most innovative, intelligent student we need to incorporate. The universities don't develop a curriculum for that, but student come up with the idea and the faculty change the curriculum depending on the need of the students. Because this is not going to be like 100 students doing this, maybe 5 students, 6 students. So those are the best model they do. For example, you do the same thing, University of Berkeley. A computer science guy completely go into data management, or he goes into electronic engineering. He's doing his computer science, but his specialization is going to be electronic engineering because he's going to develop a model on that. So most of the Western universities are opening that kind of model. And now I am talking to the IIT Mumbai, for example. So the director was telling, if someone comes with that kind of model, ideas, we will be able to modify. There's no barrier. Nobody say this is the restriction. What you have to show the curriculum pattern, and curriculums are beyond borders. We only understand them. Curriculum is a basic understanding principles of your knowledge, realizing what is, and you know the book, but thinking is beyond that process. And coming to the second point about Gayatri Mantra, you know that if physics people are there, you have Sarita and other people in physics here. For example, if you do a transmission, an analysis of wave pattern, you have Gayatri Mantra, Om Bhor Bhoso Tasetrainyam Bhargo Dhyamesidhime Diyayona Prachodayat. You put that. When you do the mantras, what you do, any music, any mantras, they have these signals, that wave pattern. The wave pattern, the brain is nothing but your wave pattern, that. Your brain thinking, your brain working, how do I know? If I don't want to do brain imaging, what I'm going to do, I put electrodes around your brain. I'm going to see, for example, you're a highly excited person, not a guy with a smoothness. Then you go through beta waves, for example. And you are highly energetic, positive thinking, and always, giving new thinking, new ideas. Then you have a alpha waves, for example. There are yogis, people go into a trance where there's no thinking. Impossible. That when you do meditation, you always close your eyes, but you see many things happening around your eye. You see running. And to reach a stage where you don't think anything is a transcendental meditation you reach. When you reach that level, you have no thinking. That means your brain wave should be straight. So alpha, beta, gamma waves, we call gamma waves. So they will be straight. So your mantras, your prayers, all of them are nothing but wave pattern matching to the wave pattern of the brain. So that is how we say that from the beginning, you see Gurukul system in India, and even when you have a school kid, you went through, first thing you do in the school is prayer. First thing you do is prayer, and then you follow his national anthem. Then afterwards you go to class, So there was a practice going on. The thing is, people were trained to understand that you should give a positive mind waves in your thick system so that you are the best student pattern in this process. So this is a very interesting concept people need to practice. That's why we tell students, you want to listen to music, keep listening and doing. People say, oh, you're listening to music, you're not able to do. Parents don't understand. Yes, the pattern of waves is very important of music, no matter mantras, no matter meditation even, always influence the people and the brain and brain activities. The last one, you have two questions, very important. One is the self-reward system and external reward system. So humans have two natures, you know that. Some people are dependable, some people are independent. So in reward system also they are like that. For example, some people say, I will work, I know myself. The person thinks reward, self-reward is satisfaction, happiness. That's what he feels. But some people are dependable, but mean they wait for somebody's reward system. Those people, that means we have to utilize both the models to make successful thinking. So depending on your human nature, we will module your reward thinking. Some people say, even I don't get, they don't worry. But some people get depressed where they're not getting reward system. So those are the kind of human psychology we use to build the process. No matter how you build, you are bringing a good thinkers into the world. Am I clear?
Yes, sir. And thank you for such a very convincing answer. From the bottom of my heart, I express my sincere gratitude to you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Any more questions, please?
Sir, I have one question. You said rewarding is beneficial to our for a better feeling. But what happens? We have some ideas, and or our students have some ideas, and it is rejected. Like as you said, it can be like a self motivation. But sometimes we have to get approval or. We have to get some confirmation from outside. So in that case, how it is going to affect ourselves?
Yeah, this is what happens in many, many places. And, we call beyond bureaucracy. Okay, this is what we call beyond bureaucracy. Sometimes, we think a student come up with the idea or a faculty come up with the idea, and then we don't know. So we always think it's not a good idea because we are not exposed to that environment. So what a faculty or the student, the management should always approach, there are other people who are in the world who understand this, so we can get their opinions. And sometimes a student come up with an idea. For example, I tell you one example. There is a work which we have done in Panama, with a cardiologist. You know that when you have a cardiac problem, massive attack, and people, doctor said the person dead, but they will try to, put the aid to give the shocks to the electrical things to the heart to revive them. That means medically they are dead because their ECG waves are straight, no wave pattern. But they survived. And then that means psychologically, medically, that the person dead. That means he cannot know anything what is happening. But when he survived after 3 minutes, 4 minutes, of the things people do that, then the person explains that you did all these things. I was watching, sitting on the wall. That means he's talking about his soul. So if you look at the composition, people were asking questions. Is it true? But this guy is able to tell everything. But he's dead. He's closed his eyes. He is not able to see anything. But all you are doing, he will tell. For example, this kind of problem came. And this was applied for a grant. And the experts rejected. They said, no, this doesn't work, this thing. These are kind of psychological, blah, blah things. Then we said the existence of soul is a phenomenal process. And people identified like aura, brain aura. People did that. So we allowed that to go through a study. We funded the project actually. And then we come up with almost 100 patients with this problem, went through this. And then at the end, we come up with a beautiful, the artificial intelligence analysis of the whole data process. And we realize, yes, the people are capable of watching out of the body. So people don't believe that. But when we do an artificial intelligence analysis, you are able to see some symptomatic things. And then we are now doing this. For example, we also did a study on EEG pattern. Make sure your brain is dead. But no. For example, after death, still you are thinking. Biologically, you are dead. But in the brain, still thinking is going on. So how long you think when your brain is going to die after your death is a question. What are you thinking after you are dead? You think you are dead. Yes, medically it's fine because your heart is done, but brain is still thinking. So we will always question what people think when they die. So there are critical questions like this people try to understand. And when such questions comes, it's very difficult for people to identify, because people, funding agencies always open up general known phenomena, not unknown phenomena. That's where we have called extraordinary fundings. That's where institutions will do that. Like means out of their money, 1% of the budget we always keep for extraordinary ideas, which are not normal, which are abnormal thinking. We put and support them, small money, say that let us try this concept. Let us do this. Sometime it will become most innovative in the world. And sometime you have no facility, we can do it outside. So there is not that it's going to be completely closed. That's why we should have a communication system with the world so that we know where we can do, where your idea can be free. You have a best idea, tell me. We can get you a position to work in some other place. But you should be the best idea. So those are the opportunities available in the world. But the colleges internally, I always suggest people to do that kind of models and to do that. I tell you one example happened in India when first carbon nanoparticle was developed, in industrial science. Even the scientists never visualized. And then when he developed the using the solid state chemistry model, he developed a carbon tube, which can withstand very high temperatures, for example. This is done in industrial science physics. But it's very interesting. He did analysis and everything and he published in Science, a top journal. The moment it published, people in the world started realizing it's a marvelous contribution, which people don't know. Even in the industrial science, nobody understood that. But the moment it said, the government of India immediately submitted a patent. They said, overnight patent they did in US. Because that is the outstanding contribution in superconductivity model. That means sometimes you miss, but the world looks at it. So that is why we need to expose ideas. You have a best idea, even make a theoretical model, publish it. People appreciate, you get support. But I always tell colleges, institutions, when you get only one idea for 3 years, 2 years, we can fund, we can do that. Starting from a minimum funding. We should do that. We cannot be last. There's no bad idea. I always tell no bad question, no bad idea. We should understand the problem clearly. We should debate and identify this best solution for that. So our innovation is not last. Am I clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you for that encouraging answer. Is there any further questions from the participants? I think there are no further questions from participants.
Thank you all.
As of now, I think we can just name the participants who asked the best questions. They are Dr. Binita Aran, Dr. Diana Ann Isaac, and Mr. Abby Thomas. So these three have asked the best question. Yes, sir.
I'm very happy you have a lot of questions. You have a lot of talent, I tell you, to the college. I think you are the best opportunities to make some of them as your real thinkers in the college. And I'm very, very positive that you will really make a big change in our education model.
So now we will have the formal vote of thanks and then we will wind up. So I'm giving the vote of thanks right now. So first of all, a big thanks to our resource person, Dr. K.S. Jagannatha Rao. He has given such an encouraging and enlightening session on novel model education, how we can encourage our faculty and students. He also listed out the various opportunities available to us. And while I approached him for this session, he was very cordial, and he gave also a creative suggestion to make the session more interactive by awarding prizes for the best questions. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and giving such a wonderful session.
Thank you very much. God bless you all.
And I'm thankful to our principal, Shanti A. Abraham, ma'am, who has been supportive of IQAZ in conducting this webinar series. And I am very much grateful to my colleagues in IQAZ and in UGC Paramount scheme. The team's support throughout is what made this event happen. And I also extend my sincere thanks to the technical support staff for helping us with live streaming on the college YouTube channel. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants who made this webinar series a success. Once again, I thank each and everyone behind this event. Thank you all.
Thank you. God bless you all.
Thank you, sir.
ഇത് ഇവിടെ എൻഡ് ചെയ്യാമോ മാം? ഞാനാണെന്ന് തോന്നുന്നു പോസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട് ഐക്യുസി. ഇത് മറ്റേ സ്ട്രീമിംഗ് അവസാനിച്ചോ?
സ്ട്രീമിംഗ് അബൌട്ട് ടു എൻഡ്.